السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, we spoke about how dua is an act of worship and how every single act of worship, for it to be accepted, firstly it should be solely for the sake of Allah Jalla wa'ala. In the same way, dua is an act of worship. It should be solely for the sake of Allah Jalla wa'ala. Allah Jalla wa'ala says in the Quran, وَمَنْ أَضَلُّ مِمَّنْ يَدْعُو مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ. Who is more misguided than the one who calls out to something other than Allah Jalla wa'ala? He calls out to this thing.
يَدْعُو مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ مَنْ لَا يَسْتَجِيبُ لَهُ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ وَهُمْ عَنْ دُعَائِهِمْ غَافِلُونَ.
He calls out to this thing that cannot respond to his dua. Even up to the day of Qiyamah, it will not be able to respond to this person's dua or to this person's call. And in fact, this thing doesn't even know about this person's dua. It is unmindful of this person's dua. Allah Jalla wa'ala says in another ayah, وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ. As for the masajid, therefore Allah Jalla wa'ala, فَلَا تَدْعُوا مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. Do not call out to anything else other than Allah Jalla wa'ala, and do not associate partners with Allah Jalla wa'ala when it comes to your acts of worship. The second condition for an act of worship to be accepted, and inshallah we will mention this today, is one should follow what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught. Al-ikhlas wal-ittiba'. The first we mentioned, al-ikhlas, that this act of worship should be solely for the sake of Allah Jalla wa'ala. The second being al-ittiba'. It should be according to what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught. That is why the one who he carries out an act of worship, but this act of worship, yes, it is solely for Allah Jalla wa'ala, but it is not according to what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught, it will not be accepted. As we mentioned before, the one, for example, who says that instead of reading 2 raka'ah of Fajr Salah, I want to read 3. His niyyah, his intention, he wants to read it solely for the sake of Allah. But he has not gone, or he has not fulfilled this act of worship according to what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught. And in the same way, if one had to fulfill an act of worship or carry out an act of worship according to what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught, but his niyyah was not for the sake of Allah. For example, he gave out some form of charity, but his intention was that people may praise him, people may say that this person is very generous. Again, his act of worship will not be accepted. So as we mentioned, dua is an act of worship. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he taught the ummah every single thing. When it comes to this deen, this religion, it is complete. Nobody is allowed to come and add anything extra. Nobody is allowed to take out or subtract anything from the deen. The deen is complete. When it comes to dua, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us how to make dua. And he taught us the occasions. On certain occasions you make certain du'as. For example, they were du'as that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught the Sahaba radiallahu anhum to make. They were du'as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself would make, whether it was in his salah, whether it was during the day. So the sunnah is complete. It is important for every single one of us to search for these du'as and to learn them, and to call Allah Jalla wa'ala with these du'as, to make the same du'a that the best of creation, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, made. And it is important that every single one of us, we do not leave the Quran and Sunnah for something which was not taught by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is sad to see that sometimes we find ourselves, we stick to those things that have no basis in the Quran and Sunnah. There is no proof for it in the Sharia of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is why sometimes people, they intend good, but the way they carry out this act of worship is
against what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught. That is why the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, one day Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he saw certain people, they were making dhikr of Allah jalla wa ala. They were remembering Allah jalla wa ala. But they were doing it in a way which was not taught by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what did Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu tell them? He told them that, have you preceded the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Or do you know more than the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Or is this something which you have innovated? So imagine, they wanted good, they intended good, they were remembering Allah jalla wa ala, but they didn't do it in the correct way. That is why Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he says, اقتصاد في سنة خير من اجتهاد في بدعة. For one to suffice when it comes to the sunnah, that is better than for him to start striving in innovations. Just follow the sunnah and carry on. Do not bring anything extra when it comes to the deen. Allah Jalla wa Ala says in the Quran, أَمْ لَهُمْ شُرَكَاءُ شَرَعُوا لَهُمْ مِنَ الدِّينِ مَا لَمْ يَأْذَنْ بِهِ اللَّهِ. To these people, are they some sort of shuraka, some sort of associates? They make new orders or they make new acts of worship when it comes to the religion of Allah Jalla wa Ala. أَمْ لَهُمْ شُرَكَاءُ شَرَعُوا لَهُمْ مِنَ الدِّينِ. They have made something new for them in the deen. مَا لَمْ يَأْذَنْ بِهِ اللَّهِ. And that thing, Allah Jalla wa Ala has not even permitted for this thing. That is why we find that the one who leaves the sunnah, especially when it comes to dua, there are a lot of ill effects or bad things that happen. For example, you find that the thing that he wants from his dua, he does not achieve it. When you make dua correctly, you find, as Allah Jalla wa Ala said in the Quran, he is close to those who make dua to him, to those who call out to him. He responds to those who call out to him. And the person himself who makes dua solely for the sake of Allah, you find his nafs is purified and his bond and relationship with Allah Jalla wa Ala becomes stronger. Also, from the disadvantages or from the ill effects of not following the sunnah, we find that one does not get the great reward promised. As for the one who follows the sunnah, he gets reward, because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught this. And this person is going according to what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said or taught. That is why in a hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, مَنْ عَمِلَ عَمَلًا لَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ أَمْرُنَا فَهُوَ رَدْ. The one who does something which we have not taught, which was not in the sharia, it will be rejected. So for those who make dua, they make dua, but in a way which is against what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught, then they find that their dua is not being accepted. They should ask themselves, where are they when it comes to this hadith? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam warned us when it came to innovation. So it is important for us to follow the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If we look at the sunnah, we find Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was granted jawami'ul kalim. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith, bu'ithtu bi jawami'ul kalim. This hadith is recorded in Bukhari and Muslim. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that he was given bi'tha, he was chosen, and Allah Jalla wa Ala had given him jawami'ul kalim. The ulama, they have mentioned what is jawami'ul kalim. They say that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was given certain things which the previous nations had to write in books. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would say it in one or two words. That was jawami'ul kalim. He used to say very little, but this very little had so many meanings to it. That is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is recorded in the hadith that he used to like the dua that was jami', the dua that had very little words, but they had great meaning. For example, from the dua of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would say, Allahumma inni as'aluka min al-khayri kullih, ajilihi wa ajilih, ma alimtu minhu wa ma lam a'lam. He would ask Allah Jalla wa Ala for every form of goodness, ajilihi wa ajilih, whether it is
in the near future, whether it is coming quickly or it will come later. All forms of goodness he asked for in this dua. And he sought refuge in Allah Jalla wa Ala. When asking for goodness, he said, the goodness, whether I know this goodness or I don't know about this goodness. Imagine. And when it came to seeking refuge in Allah Jalla wa Ala, he sought refuge from all the evils, whether he knew or he did not know. That evil which was close or that which was still further away, he sought refuge in Allah Jalla wa Ala. So it is important for us, as we mentioned, to follow the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to learn these du'as. If we look at the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when it came to their du'as. And they did not invent anything new. They went according to what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught. That is why Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he says, in fact it is Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu, he says that there will come a time where the Qur'an, every single person will be able to take it, whether they are big or small, whether they are Arabs or non-Arabs, men and women, children, slaves, etc. Then one will feel that I have learned the Qur'an, but nobody is listening to me. I have no following. So I have to make a new innovation in order for people to follow me. So he says, beware of this innovation and don't follow these type of people. That is why if you look at those who advise solely for the sake of Allah Jalla wa Ala, they bring you or they teach you that which is in the Quran and Sunnah. They do not call to themselves. They call to that which is in the Quran and the Sunnah. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum would always ask Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when it came to du'as. And sometimes Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would teach them certain du'as. And to show the emphasis of these du'as and to show how they used to follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if they had to make a mistake in one word or they had to change it to a word which had similar meaning, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would correct them. That is why in a hadith which is recorded in Sahih Muslim from the hadith of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to teach us this du'a in the same way he used to teach us a surah from the Quran. He used to say, Allahumma inna na'udhu bika min adab jahannam. Oh Allah, we seek refuge in you from the fire of jahannam. Wa a'udhu bika min adab al-qabr. And I seek refuge from you from the punishment of the grave. Wa a'udhu bika min fitnati al-masih ad-dajjal. And I seek refuge in you from the fitna, from the trial of the antichrist. Wa a'udhu bika min fitnati al-mahya wal-mamat. And I seek refuge in you from the fitna, whether it's in this world, whether it's after death, all types of fitna. They used to seek refuge in Allah Jalla wa Ala. So we should make these du'as. Also, it is recorded in Sahih al-Bukhari that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to teach the Sahaba the du'a for istikhara. When one wants to carry out something and he is unsure whether to do it or not to do it, he is ordered to do what is known as istikhara. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would teach the Sahaba radiallahu anhum the istikhara in the same way he would teach them a surah from the Quran. Also, it is recorded in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim from the hadith of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. He says that he told Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, teach me a dua that I can make this dua in my salah. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught him the dua, Allahumma inni zalamtu nafsi zulman kathira wa la yaghfiru dhunuba illa ant faghfir li maghfiratan min indik warhamni innaka antal ghafurur rahim. Oh Allah, I have oppressed myself in a very big way and there is nobody who forgives sins except you. So forgive me. مَغْفِرَةً مِّنْ عِنْدِكَ وَرْحَمْنِي إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Forgive me. Have mercy on me. Verily you are most forgiving, most merciful. Also, as we mentioned, if the Sahaba radiallahu anhum would make or would change a small letter, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would correct them. In a long hadith, which is again recorded in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim from the hadith of Al-Bara ibn Azib radiallahu anhu. He says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when you want to go to sleep, you should make your wudu in the same way you would make wudu for salah. Then you should lie down on your right side. Then say the dua, Allahumma inni aslamtu wajhi ilayk. وفوضت أمري إليك وألجأت ظهري إليك رغبة ورهبة إليك لا ملجأ ولا منجا منك إلا إليك آمنت بكتابك الذي أنزلت وبنبيك الذي أرسلت. He says if you read this dua فإن مت مت على الفطرة. You will die on فطرة. So when البراء ابن عازب رضي الله عنه was reading this dua, he, instead of saying وبنبيك الذي أرسلت, by asking Allah Jalla wa Ala, when he says that I have believed in your books, O Allah, that you have sent, and in your Nabis that you have sent, instead of saying wa bi nabiyyika alladhi arsalt, he said wa bi rasulika alladhi arsalt. Similar meaning. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, no, you should say wa bi nabiyyika alladhi arsalt. Look at how the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum and how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would emphasize following the sunnah. Also it is recorded in a hadith of Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu. And this hadith shows us some of the advantages when one makes dua according to the sunnah. And it shows us some of the ill effects when one leaves the sunnah. In a hadith which is recorded in Sahih Muslim from the hadith of Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu, he says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam visited a man from the Muslimin who was very sick. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, he said, were you making dua for anything? Or did you ask Allah jalla wa ala for anything? So the man said, yes, I used to say, oh Allah, whatever punishment is going to afflict me in the akhirah, bring it forward so that I can take it in the dunya. In other words, I don't have to suffer that punishment in the akhirah. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Subhanallah, glory be to Allah, you will never be able to handle this punishment. He said, why didn't you say, Allahumma atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhab an-nar. Oh Allah, grant us goodness in the dunya and grant us goodness in the akhirah and save us from the punishment. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made dua for him and he was cured. We ask Allah jalla wa ala to make us from those who follow the sunnah when it comes to dua. Inshallah, we will speak about al-i'tida fi dua, exceeding the limits in dua, and how Allah jalla wa ala in the Quran warned us against exceeding the limits. And how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke about how if one had to exceed the limits, what is the condition of his dua. We ask Allah jalla wa ala to grant us goodness, to forgive us. We ask him to forgive our parents, to forgive our mashayikh, to forgive all the Muslimin, those who are alive and those who have passed away. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. اللهم صل وسلم على عبدك ورسولك نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.